Hello, everybody. My name is Nikita Zimov, and today we'll be talking with you about our project called Pleistocene Park, which is an attempt to create northern Serengeti and mitigate climate change. So I came to you from a remote Arctic research station, which is called Northeast Scientific Station. It is located at the Kolyma River lowland, and it is one of the largest Arctic research stations globally. So just this year, we had more than 100 visitors, so scientists and media people from Russia and the rest of the world. And over the last 30 years, we were conducting research, and based on that research, we have published hundreds of research articles, including a series of articles in Science and Nature magazine. And my talk, I will want to start with some background. So just during the last ice age, the world's largest ecosystem was called the Mammoth Steppe. The richness of this ecosystem has no present-day analogs. On every square kilometer of pastures in this ecosystem, we were roaming tens of big herbivores. At the same time, this ecosystem accumulated enormous amounts of carbon in the soil and permafrost. And some of this carbon is still preserved till nowadays. So in the permafrost of Siberia, in a relatively small portion of Siberia, there is more organic carbon in the permafrost than in all above-ground vegetation of the planet. So all the trees of the tropical forest and boreal forest weigh less than these tiny roots. Unfortunately, shortly after the end of Ice Age, first humans entered the Arctic and quickly dropped the number of animals. And the reality is that grasses cannot compete against mosses, shrubs, and trees without help of animals. And just a few centuries later, the Arctic began to look like that. So mostly low productive ecosystems with little to no animals. This ecosystem does not provide any benefits to humans, and the only creatures which live in this ecosystem in abundance are mosquitoes. And however, the backward shift is also possible. So if in the past humans managed to destroy this ecosystem by reducing the number of animals and keep it at low for an extended period of time, we can do the opposite. We can increase the number of animals and density of animals and keep it artificially high for an extended period of time to allow animals to allow grasses to establish and allow these animals to make an ecosystem where they can live in big numbers. So this is pretty much the essence of the Pleistocene Park project. It was founded by my father, Sergei Zimov, back in the 90s. So back at that time, we obtained a relatively big piece of land from the Russian government, and we fenced part of it and started to bring animals in. So first, we started with animals which we could find locally, so like moose, semi-wild Yakutian horses, domestic reindeer. And unfortunately, these are all only three types of animals we could find locally. And for all other animals, we had to make relatively complicated journeys. And I will show some slides. So this example, our trip to the Wrangel Island in 2010 to catch some muskox. So that was our ocean-class cruise ship, which we used. So it took us 7 days to find the path through the floating ice to get to the island. And we saw some wildlife on the way. And a little bit more. So there on the island, we spent 10 days trying to catch baby muskox. And they've been tranquilized. And after that, they slept for 5 hours. And you know, Wrangel Island is actually a very cold island. And for 5 hours, to keep myself warm, I was cuddling with the muskox. So that was our catch, which we got into the deck of the boat and started to head back home. And fortunately, on the way back, there was no ice. But we were in quite a bad storm for 2 days in the open ocean. But fortunately, everything went fine, and all the muskox safely made it to the park, and that's some of them a few years later. And another expedition I want to briefly show is actually happened just this spring. We, for 20 years, been trying to bring American bison to the Pleistocene Park, and finally we managed to do that. And you may be wondering why we chose this route, but trust me, that was the easiest and the cheapest. So we got them at a very lovely bison farm in Denmark. And through Europe, they were going on the very fancy cow bus. So that's a look from the inside. And at the Russian border, we moved it to our truck and started to go east. And since it was a long journey, we were giving them enough water, food, and we're cleaning their container every few days to make sure the trip is going well. And, you know, as eastern part of Russia is not known for its good roads, so sometimes we had to use ferries to cross the rivers, and we were going on the dirt roads through the mountains until we finally reached the small river port not far from the Pacific coast. And from there, the bison continued their journey down the Kolyma River on the little barge, for another 1,500 kilometers. And that's this picture is taken on day 35 when they're actually entering the park territory. And it was spring flood time on the Kolyma. You see everything is flooded. And that's them already this summer. So you may be wondering why we're doing all these crazy expeditions. And there is several reasons. First of all, establishing a high productive grazing ecosystem in the Arctic will have various social economical benefits. Like, for instance, if you have a northern Serengeti, it's a very nice tourist attraction, especially if one day some geneticist will finally return the mammoth or so-called cold-adapted elephant. I'm sure it will be attraction. However, main reason, and almost the only reason why we are doing that, is because this ecosystem actually can be used as a tool to mitigate climate change. So the problem, which you probably already heard multiple times in the past few days, that Arctic is warming much faster than the rest of the world, and permafrost is not so permanently and not so frozen anymore. So the temperature of permafrost is rising, and in some places, degradation is already taking place. And as I already told you, there's a huge carbon storage. And when permafrost thaws, the microbes awakens and convert this carbon to greenhouse gases, CO2 and methane. So methane is produced underneath the lakes, and in this case, such a fun entertainment is possible. Let me see if it will be playing.
Так, я готов. Вот и все. Водить я снимать буду. Убирай хорошо, Настя. Аккуратненько стройки. Широко не надо, чтобы ее потом расчистить. Хорош. У нас тут лопаты нет? Лопаты какие-то.
So I would say that it's something that they mean by saying the dangerous greenhouse gas. But let's say jokes aside, there is a I think consensus to understand that permafrost degradation is considered as one of the strongest, if not the strongest, positive feedback to the climate change. And there is something has to be done about it. So this 1,000 gigaton in the top 3 meters, 1,000 gigaton is 100,000 billions of tons. It's 1 century of modern anthropogenic emissions. So that's a very serious deal. And the reason why permafrost is actually, even in the high Arctic, is relatively warm is because in the summer, high temperatures reaching the ground, soil, and permafrost underneath without any barrier. And in the winter, the snowpack is forming, and it's acting as a heat insulating. So it doesn't matter how cold it is outside, with the snow, the soil will not be very cold. And that's where the animals can actually help. If you have a pasture underneath the snow, the animals will come there several times a year, and they will dig through the snow looking for food, and they will trample down the snow. And the snow will be thin and dense, and it will lose most of its heat insulating abilities. And realistically, this effect can have a 2 to 3 degrees cooling on the permafrost, which is quite substantial. Second independent mechanism why grasses and grazing ecosystems are beneficial for the climate, it's called albedo effect. You can see that grasses are lighter than forest. And in this sense, the lighter the surface, the more energy is reflected back to space. And especially this is pronounced in the spring. So in our region, in April and May, we have enormous amounts of sun already. And all the trees are standing dark, and the stems actually melt in the snow around them. And the stems are staying white, and the albedo kind of is very high. So they reflect most of the energy back to space. And third is that unlike most of the modern vegetation in the Arctic, grasses are forming deep root system. And what is the root? So it was the CO2 in the atmosphere, which got absorbed by the photosynthesis, and plants grew the root into the ground, in the cold soil, where you can actually create a very substantial carbon pool. So you can sequester carbon from the atmosphere directly into the soil. And here we did an estimation of the oldest territory in the park, which is just 40 hectares. where we have more or less active grazing in the last 20 years. And we did intensive drilling campaign last spring inside the park and outside of the park. And we saw that we indeed have a substantial increase in carbon concentration within the soil. And to put this study into some context, I decided to look at my personal carbon footprint. So as a person who lives in the Arctic and uses the least efficient vehicles to drive, like outboard motors and snowmobiles, actually my carbon footprint is quite high. So, and I use lots of energy to heat my house. But at the same time, I am the person who is developing the park, and everything that's happening there, I think I can take at least half of the credits. And I estimated that over these 15 years, we got 1,300 tons of carbon into the ground. So, and we finally got this number. So, you know, I don't have many powers, and my efforts with park is actually relatively sparse. But at the same time, I managed to become a carbon negative person. So I know, you know, 1,000 tons is nothing compared with the 10 billions of tons, which is emitted by our civilization every year, but you have to start with something. And overall goal of the park, of the Pleistocene Park, is to create an ecosystem which will be self-sustainable and be able to expand by its own until it actually reaches the scales where it can actually affect the climate. And there is many steps to be done before that. So you've got to have more animals, more land, more grasses. And you've got to have predators eventually. And that's lots of job. And skeptics of the project say, well, you know, kind of maybe it's too late, it's too hard to be done. And to them, I would want to reply with a little tale. So three mice fall into the jar with milk in the kitchen. And the first one seemed like, oh, so much milk. And it just swims and starts drinking milk, drinking until it choked and drowned. And the second mouse, it saw the threat, but it saw that, oh, the walls are too far, the milk is too deep. Like, why should I kind of try? I would rather dive and not to dive out. So that's what she did. So she dived and never dived out. And the last mouse, so it just kept trying and trying. It's kind of make no sense, but I will keep trying. And it was keeping trying, until she actually turned milk into butter and got out. So I personally see myself as this third mouse, and I would really encourage all of you to adopt the same vision. So, and I think from here I can take questions. Thank you very much.